Hi, I'm the Space Quest historian. Let's talk genres and marketing and other similarly wildly interesting topics. Admittedly, I haven't quite got a full sort of overview about this topic or what I'm about to talk about. I've tried sort of coming up with some talking points, but they all just start to meld together and, you know, I'm just gonna rant away. Anyway, so for the past couple of evenings, I've started getting into a comfortable rhythm where I have like an hour to myself to work on my games, actually. I'm gonna finish one and then start work on the other, and then hopefully people will come in and actually make the first one look nice. Because that's my big Achilles heel. I can't make things look nice. I have to get other people to make it look nice. But at least I can coat the fucker up and then start working on the other one while the first one gets a pretty little makeover. And eventually this game or these games are going to go on Steam, itch, places where people can search for and download them at the cost of not very much. And you know, you have to pick a genre. You have to pick some sort of box to put this fucker in. And I'm not sure I want that box to be labeled adventure game. Because, don't get me wrong, they are adventure games. They are story-driven games. You walk around, you talk to NPCs, you solve puzzles, I guess, technically. Now, here's the thing. Game A is more like a visual novel with adventure game elements in it. It's more like a walking simulator slash visual novel thing. There aren't really any puzzles to speak of. You don't actually solve puzzles. You just explore and you look through people's shit. And the more you look through people's shit, the more you get to know the characters, which comes in handy down the line. And it's a very short game. Game B is more in your traditional, hi, I'm a protagonist, now I'm going to go on a quest and I'm going to save the world kind of thing. But again, I'm not sure I want to label them as adventure games. Not because they're not adventure games, because they're made in adventure game studios, so obviously they share a commonality with adventure games. But if you go on Steam, or GOG for that matter, or itch, and you look up adventure games and point-and-click games, you get a lot of, this game was inspired by the classics, or this game pays homage to the heydays of Sierra and LucasArts. It's almost like adventure games, point-and-click games, which are now apparently interchangeable labels, by the way, but they just haven't evolved since the early to mid 90s, apparently. I just went on Steam and had a search for adventure game classics and just looked through the list and went into, you know, Steam page after Steam page for game after game and just looked at either the reviewer, the reviewers, the quotes from the reviewers, or the person actually writing the Steam page copy. Somewhere in there, the words inspired by the classic adventure games of old, or a point-and-click game like you've played a million times, that kind of terminology just gets batted around a lot. And now here's the thing. I think, and I'm going to need people in the comments or whatever to sort of weigh in, yay or nay, or because that's what a horse does. Nay, get it? No, never mind. You're gonna have to weigh in because this is just off the top of my head, but I have this notion that there are three kinds of players in this world. The kind who are into adventure games, and they are typically of the older guard, myself included. These are people who grew up playing adventure games in the early 90s. Perhaps they were children or teenagers in the late 80s, early 90s, and they quite enjoy adventure games. That would, you know, that would probably constitute the majority of people watching this. I honestly don't know. There's I'm going to leave out the middle one, because then there's the opposite side of the spectrum. There are people who have no interest in adventure games, or story in games for that matter. These are people who are into competitive gaming. They're into esports, they're into death matches, they're into, and peace be with them. They're probably not going to be interested in whatever I have to show them anyway. And fair play to that. There's nothing wrong with that. That's just not who I'm making games for. But then there's the middle ground. I don't know how we landed on this finger, but here it is. There's the middle ground where they like a game with a good story. They even like games that have adventure game elements. But as soon as you say adventure game to them or point and click game to them, they're instantly reminded of, oh, it's that shit my dad plays, and he keeps going on about it, and it's like Moon Logic. There's a lot of pie throwing and yetis and shit, and I'm just not into. No, I don't like it. It's just, and they've sort of made a foregone conclusion that adventure games are not for them. But these are the same people who will play Firewatch or Gone Home or Edith Finch and go, this is a very lovely game. It's a lovely narrative exploration. I desperately love it. They'll play Fallout, which I know it's an RPG, but they'll play Fallout and go, oh, I like how I can interrogate each NPC. There's a dialogue tree that comes up. Yes, and it changes Mass Effect. You have certain elements of the story that changes depending on your outcome. I love that sort of thing. And then you go, well, that's kind of adventure gamey. So what's wrong with adventure game? Oh, yetis and pies. And fair play to that as well, because adventure games of especially the mid-90s, but let's be fair, a lot of shit during the majority of that decade came out that didn't really paint adventure games in a very good light. And there happened to be, at least, again, someone has to fill in the blanks here for me, but there seems to be an awful lot of people out there who kind of want to go back to this style. There's a lot of retro adventure games out there. Fair play to those as well. They're gorgeous, and they probably perform exactly to the specifications that the designers intended, as in scratching that nostalgic itch. But there's a lot of nostalgia in it. I was about to go down a tangent there. Let's just say that there's a lot of emphasis on nostalgia and the classics in even modern day adventure game pitches, which I feel sort of limits their scope, their audience, their reach before it's even had a chance. As soon as you put inspired by classic point-and-click adventure games, you've automatically cut off like 50% of people who would otherwise enjoy your game, but you've already put it in a box that to them says Yeti Moon Pies. And no one, that's weird. So I don't think I want to label my games as adventure games, but what else are we going to call them? They're games, you go on an adventure. Narrative games? I remember Adventure X made a big deal of the convention. Adventure X made a big deal about saying that it was a convention for adventure games and narrative-driven games. So they could have the interactive fiction guys, the text adventure guys, they could have point-and-clickies, they could have visual novels, they could have anything, walking simulators, they could have anything that had a story in it. Which I'm sort of more comfortable with, because A, that means I don't have to fall in line with expectations. Oh, this game is too easy. The puzzles are too easy. It's like, yeah, but you're not really here for the puzzles. I have a story to tell. Conversely, there are adventure game players who will much rather be challenged by a lot of puzzles and the story's kind of secondary. Or there are people who are more interested in the story and then they get frustrated with a game because the puzzles are just too challenging or too out there or require too much, again, in the Moon Logic territory. And there's a whole subgenre of that I refer to as German game design, which I admit is kind of unfair, but a lot of, especially German adventure games I've played, they really like the puzzle aspects of adventure games, and they have a tendency to just shove a million inventory items in your face from the get-go and then let you loose into a world and expect you to get on with it, and you're not entirely sure what it is, but off you go. So I'm trying very hard not to do that. And then on the other side of the spectrum, you've got Dave Gilbert and Wedged Eye games that are very much story first, and puzzles, whenever they show up, are just sort of there to give the player something to do in between story beats. which is fine, which is fair. And then you've got walking simulators, which I absolutely adore walking simulators, where gameplay is really, really just secondary. You're really just moving from one place to another. Sometimes you get to solve like a little mini puzzle. Gone Home had a safe where you need to find a combination. But that's I mean, you could call that a puzzle, sure. You could also call it exploration. You can call it uncovering a story, which is really what I'm about. So I'm, yeah. If that's the little bow I'm going to tie around this whirlwind of unstructured rantiness, I think it is that I am making adventure games, and I want fellow developers to make their adventure games however they see fit, but I don't want to be constrained by the expectations of what an adventure game is, and I also don't want to label my games as adventure games for fear of alienating people who might enjoy them, but are put off just from the fact that it says point-and-click or adventure game somewhere in the description. Which, I guess, would also alienate people who are interested, like old farts, the first category, myself included, the old farts who actually are looking for adventure games. I don't know. People are weird. And I guess so am I. So, thank you for listening to whatever the hell this was. I'll see you around the Chrono Stream. Bye.